Hi, I'm Herb Kressel, editor of Radiology, and today I'm delighted to be joined by Dr. Ron Summers, who is a senior investigator of the Imaging Biomarker and Computer-Aided Diagnosis Laboratory at the NIH Clinical Center. And full disclosure, I know Ron probably from medical school and certainly from residency, and I've been delighted to watch his career develop. And Ron is a senior author on a paper entitled Distributed Human Intelligence for Colonic Polyp Classification in Computer-Aided Detection for CT Colonography. And I must say, in the years that I've been reading the journal and now editing it, this was, I found, one of the most fascinating submissions and papers that we've really had. So, Ron, thanks for coming by, and we're delighted to chat with you.
Oh, it's a great pleasure to be here.
So, first, let's start off and start simple. What exactly is the concept of distributed human intelligence?
Right. So, this is something that I learned about just recently, which is a way to harness the power of people over the internet to help do relatively straightforward tasks. And in this particular case, what we were trying to do was have people, lay people, look at computer-aided detection marks for CT colonography polyp detection and determine whether the marks were on true polyps or whether they were false marks on normal colonic mucosa. So in this situation, I guess in a more general sense, distributed human intelligence is the harnessing of lay people over the internet to do small tasks.
So what's it, how do you know which one is right? Do you sort of pick your best one, or is the idea sort of the wisdom of the crowds that somehow through the magic of the human combined intelligence, the right information will bubble to the top?
That's pretty much it, and I guess that's where the term crowdsourcing comes in, because what we do is we don't take any one person's word as the truth. We, in this particular experiment, we had 20 people look at each CAD mark, and then the fraction of those people that thought it was a polyp, that was the score for that particular mark.
I see. So. Before we go on to the study, where do you find these people? You put out a tweet, I'm Ron looking for CT colonography readers. How did you get a hold of them?
This is the great thing. There are companies out there that their job is to serve as the middleware or middleman, middle woman, to connect these lay people to groups, individuals, companies, researchers, who have these small tasks.
So they're people aggregators.
They are people aggregators.
Okay. And is it like Craigslist? You go on and you have, I need someone to read CT colon, I want someone to tell me about games, or what sort of tasks do these people do?
The number of tasks are just massive. There are thousands, tens of thousands of these tasks, maybe more. They don't pay very much, and we can talk more about that later, because I think you'll be surprised how little they pay. But they range from things like, look at this picture and categorize it as to whether it shows a product or a person or whatever. Giving opinions about things, various opinions. Looking up things on the internet and collecting information and
amazing. So tell us now, specifically, you sort of mentioned you wanted to see how the crowdsourcing could look at CAD-marked lesions, or possible lesions, and how they could discern them. Now, normally, that's what a radiologist does. So you're having them emulate a radiologist's function. And so tell us, what were you trying to learn with this study?
So I've been working on CAD or CAD for CT colonography for over 10 years. And as the CAD systems are getting better, what we're finding is that the radiologists don't achieve the full potential benefit of the CAD. When the CAD points at a true polyp, sometimes the radiologists don't think it's a polyp.
So the CAD is better than the radiologist, but the radiologist doesn't know it.
Sometimes.
Yes, okay.
And the flip side is that almost all CAD systems produce more false positive marks.
Yes.
As many radiologists may know from the case with mammography CAD, which is more prevalent, they may have more experience with. So that's the other thing I've been trying to understand. Why is it that sometimes radiologists look at a false CAD mark and decide that it's a polyp? And so, you know, some of this gets into the realm of psychology. Why do people make the decisions that they make? Yeah. And I've been trying to figure out how to approach that problem. And the typical way that we do it is observer performance experiments. We have radiologists use the CAD and then see what they do. And an ongoing frustration has been that it's very time-consuming and expensive to do an observer performance project. And when I learned about distributed human intelligence, I had this eureka moment where I thought, is it possible to use this to gain some insight into why people don't make the correct decision?
Right.
And so, of course, one of the issues with distributed human intelligence is you're not using experts, you're using lay people. And we can talk about that more.
Okay, sure. Well, why don't you just summarize what you learned from your study? What were the results?
Well, what was fascinating was how easily we could recruit people for this experiment and how well they did.
How well did they do?
Right. So they achieved fairly high sensitivities when their results were aggregated, and we assessed their performance using a receiver operating characteristic analysis, or ROC analysis, where the area under the curve is considered the metric of performance. And they got areas under the curve in the high 80s, 80 percentile, which is pretty good for one of these experiments. And when we compared how they did to a trained computer system, we found that they did just as well with less training. We did give them a little training, but not as much training as the computer had, and they did very well. And
so maybe get them to play chess against the computer.
Right.
I wonder how they would do with that.
Right.
Okay. So if they did well, so how does that result? How will that affect CAD development for one?
Right. So. There are several ways that it can help with CAD development. First, there are strategies one can use to modify what the CAD marks look like that might lead to more accurate diagnoses by experts. And one of the things that we're exploring is how to use the type of display. So in this particular project, we showed static 2D and 3D images. But radiologists who are familiar with CT colonography know that typically the workstations that a radiologist uses provide interactivity with the images. You can scroll the image, you can do a fly-through of the colon. These individuals could not do that. So in our follow-on experiments, we are improving these visualization capabilities to see.
It's interesting. As you're speaking, I'm reminded, I'm sure you know, I was a GI radiologist and a barium student for many years. And when I first started as a resident, we had a very interesting form of distributed intelligence because I was working with a technologist and I had the fluoro carriage and it was a GI study. And I kept moving it. And then all of a sudden I couldn't move the carriage. It was just kind of seemed stuck and I'm pushing it and I'm pushing it. And the carriage won't move. And then finally I look and I see, it's over a huge gastric ulcer, and it was the tech who was my distributed intelligence, and it was the display. She wouldn't let it get off the screen. She didn't want to insult me by telling me that I was missing this large thing, and so we even had distributed human intelligence before we had computers. So should radiologists be worried? Is this sort of the new threat to job security, that we'll have armies of people who will be able to when combined, have better diagnostic performance than highly trained, highly educated radiologists?
So I'm frequently asked this question when I describe this project. And personally, I don't think that's the direction that this is going to go in. I think this is a tool for understanding how people think about different types of images and strategies to improve the performance of experts by learning from non-experts who are more readily available. So I do see this technique being extended to other types of imaging problems. I do see it being used to create large observer performance studies to understand how to reduce these errors that I described earlier. And I think the outcome will be better CAD systems, but no, it's extremely unlikely that anyone would tolerate having random people on the internet doing their diagnosis.
Well, that's a relief. So before we go, yes, you have something. And now, what's the qualifier?
Well, what was interesting was how reproducible the experiment was. Wow. We did it twice, and the knowledge workers, as we call them, did just as well on the repeat study, even though it was a different group of individuals. So that lends to the scientific credence and potential utility of this.
So we're going to have to stop in a moment, but just to give the radiologists who may be observing this a little bit of anxiety, what was the cost of a crowdsourcing experiment?
We paid 1 penny per decision.
Wow.
And we had...
how many decisions in one examination typically?
So there were 20 decisions per CAD mark.
Wow.
We had about 10 CAD marks per patient, and we did the experiment twice. And I think the total cost of this experiment with over 220 participants was about $250.
Well, with that note of comfort, I'm glad my mother is not alive to hear that, all of her investments in medical school. But anyway, Ron, really thanks for coming by and what is really a fascinating line of research. Thanks so much.
My pleasure.